It's now my pleasure to introduce our keynote speaker for today, Andreia Inamorato. Andreia is an international researcher, lecturer, public speaker, and consultant in digital education. She has over 25 years' experience in teaching and research in education, working internationally with institutions in Latin America, Europe, the USA, and Africa. She holds a PhD in educational technologies from the Open University of the United Kingdom. Currently, she works as a scientific officer at the European Commission Joint Research Center. Her main projects are the Open EDU Framework for Open Education, the DigComp EDU Framework for the Digital Competence of Educators, and her research on blockchain in education. Please welcome Andreia to the stage to talk about educating for the future, the transformative power of openness.
Thank you very much, Marie, for the kind introduction. Good morning, everyone. Excellent. I see everybody has had breakfast today. Excellent. Welcome to day two. Welcome to this morning session. It's really wonderful to see so many people around. You've got such a good energy. I hope we can exchange some of this nice energy today. So, as introduced by Marie, I am a researcher mostly in education, in educational technology. And I hope that we'll be able to reflect together upon education, educational technology, and our roles, knowing in trying to push the education for the future and the future of education. So, I would like to start by telling you a tale, a short story. I think that many of you may know the story of the six blind men and the elephant. I can see some people nodding, they know. Fantastic. I think it's a very inspiring story. It's a story about six blind men who lived in a small village in India. And they were all discussing what an elephant would look like. No? So they had, each one of them had their own theories about it. Until one day, the gardener of the village, who looked after the garden, or the garden of the palace, told them, look, why don't you come over and I will show you an elephant. We have an elephant there. So you can have a look, you can touch it because they couldn't see anything, they were blind, and you can have a better idea of what an elephant is like. And they said, great, let's go there. So they went there, and each one of them had the opportunity to get close to the elephant and to touch the elephant, no? So the first one touched the side of the elephant, and he said, oh, it's very solid. It looks like a wall, you know, so an elephant must be like a wall. The second one approached the elephant and touched the limber trunk of the elephant, and he said, oh, that feels strange. It feels like a snake, so an elephant must be like a snake. The third one approached the elephant, touched the elephant on the pointed tusk, no? And said, oh, this is very sharp. This is very strange. It feels like a weapon of some sort. Okay, an elephant must be like a weapon. Okay. Then the fourth man approached the elephant and touched the ear and said, this is strange. This is big. You know, it's kind of okay. It must be a fan. So that was the idea. The fifth one touched the leg and said, wow, it looks like a big cow. No, to me, an elephant is like a big cow. And finally, the last one touched the tail of the elephant and felt it like a rope and said, an elephant must be like a rope. So each one of them had this different idea of the elephant. And then they started arguing again in the garden of the palace what an elephant was like. And then the Raja, the prince, woke up. He was having a nap, he woke up and said, hey, come on, stop arguing. You've just woken me up. An elephant is none of those things. It's all of those things together because you have only touched a single part of the elephant, right? So I think this short tale illustrates a little bit, and I really want to use it as a metaphor today throughout my talk, about what happens when we get too close to what we are doing, no? And what happens to when we step out a little bit and see things from a distance, no? So we, in education as practitioners, all of us have a different role. We are teachers, we are developers. Some of us are students, some are headmasters, researchers. We all have our beautiful role to play in education, and we are very close to it, no? But when we step out a little bit and see the magnitude of the elephant, no? The magnitude of what we are doing, then we have a better understanding of our individual role in the future of education, right? So I invite you to come through this journey with me. And here again, here the proper elephant, no? Just have a look at it, and then trying to imagine what would be the feel to touch the elephant, to feel its warmth as a living being. Sure. And so I think this gives us an idea of how different it may be when we are very close, you know, the sensations, the emotions. Let's think about the feelings that we have towards what we do, towards education, no? And then when we step out a little bit, how we can perceive it from a distance. Right? So this is the invitation I make you to reflect with me. Okay, so now, talking about the future of education, educating for the future. No? To me, both things converge together, obviously, but there is a slight difference in my conception. So it's my way of looking at the elephant, okay? I'm sure you all have your own way, and it's fine. But let's think, the future of education for me is ever more technological. And it's fantastic, no? It involves virtual reality, augmented reality, algorithms, artificial intelligence, learning platforms, immersive platforms of all sorts, and this is fantastic. I've been working in the field of distance education for over 20 years, and I remember when people were very reluctant to accept, no, e-learning, online learning. I remember once giving a talk somewhere in which the pedagogy students were in front of the main entrance of the building protesting against the event on distance education. They said it could never be quality education. Luckily, we have overcome that, or we are about to overcome that, and fully embrace and accept technologies of all sorts in education. Although we know that we need to focus not only on the technology, but also on the pedagogy, no? The pedagogical side, on how we teach and how we engage students, and that's also very important. No? So the future of education for me is really a future towards the good of the technology to help us engage students in different way with the world we live in. However, educating for the future, in my perception, goes a little beyond that. It goes beyond technology. It's really about us thinking of how, you know, we plan education in such a way that it will be preparing those students personally in their own well-being, their understanding of themselves and of the world around them, but also how they can have an impact in the society. Because as Martin said yesterday, we are all connected. No, there is always this flow between us. So it's the idea of getting close to the elephant, no? What we do with our technologies, with our LMSs, with our codes, and stepping out and see how it can be a driving force for change. And that type of change I name transformative innovation. It's not just any innovation, it's just not a new piece of innovation. It's some sort of innovation that can actually provoke change at a societal level that is much deeper, no, than small changes, and we all can contribute to that. So, my invitation is for us to think today centrally in the student, having the student at the center, and also ourselves. Thinking of ourselves as important actors in this change, in what we do. So you can perhaps think of each one of those in the photographs. You could be there as well. It doesn't matter the age. It doesn't matter where we come from. If we are young students, if we are lifelong learners, everybody is invited in this journey. By the way, most of what we'll talk about today is going to be European-centered, because that's where I come from. No, I work, well, I'm actually Brazilian, Spanish-Brazilian, in case you are wondering about my accent, right? But I work for the European Commission, so most of what I'm going to show you today relates to Europe. But I am sure, absolutely sure, that these challenges can apply to other parts of the world. No? So I also ask you to reflect what it would look like in your own context, because I know you're very diverse here, no? How many of you are from Latin America? Is there anyone from Latin America? Okay, brilliant, okay. from the north, United States, Canada. Okay, fantastic. Okay, Europe, probably the majority because we are in Barcelona. Okay, so it's good. Okay, so we are going to be talking mostly about Europe. Australia, New Zealand, fantastic. Welcome, everyone. So please, let's try and think about our own contexts as well. Okay, so I propose a threefold perspective to treating the theme education for the future, right? The first one is a perspective, it's really talking about this post-industrial digital society that we live in nowadays. You know, yesterday Martin talked about the evolutionary aspect, you know, of the human being. So today we are going to talk about a little bit of this evolution in terms of how we relate to each other in society, you know, which is absolutely important when we are talking about learning and we are talking about impact of what we do. Whether we are close to the elephant or whether we are from far away and thinking of education more globally. So then we're going to talk a little bit about societal challenges related to the twin transition. I don't know how many of you have heard of this word or this way of talking about the challenges, but in European policy, this is a key word now. Everywhere in all European documents, you're going to look and see the twin transition, and also a new concept that relates to that, which is the triple transition. And finally, as promised in the title of my talk, we are going to talk about openness, open education, and its transformative power. So I invite you now to get going. For everyone who has a laptop or a mobile phone, please jump into slido.com just now. Let's get hands-on a little bit. slido.com. You can type that code, 7440996. There are three questions there for you to answer. And we are going to go back to see the results of those questions towards the end. Okay? So please, have a look there. Let me know if it's working. I hope it is. Yeah? All the three questions. If not, please shout, and I'll try and fix it. But let's just quickly go there, give your answer. And we'll look at, you know why? Because when we talk about open education, it's such a broad term, you know, everyone has a different understanding. No, I assure you that you're not gonna have the same answer depending on who you ask. You can try it yourself later on. So let's see what comes up. Using one or two words, what it means to you, whether open educational practices, which are the open educational practices, OEP, you're most familiar with, and whether you know what smart specialization is about. Thank you. Meanwhile, we'll move on. So we'll start with the first one, individualism and collectivism, what I like to call tribalism. But you see, I've put some words in there below, but don't take them as negative words, because we can easily understand complexity and chaos as something negative. But I just want to show you, you know, how we can look at them and the power of transformation that they have. So you're going to talk a little bit about complexity, chaos, authority, individualism, otherness, and tribalism as some of the characteristics of the post-industrial society, the society we live in nowadays. And mostly these things are the type of sensations in which our students are embedded in on a daily basis, and we as educators have to live with that. Okay, contemporary society. Nowadays we have more choices. Do you realize that? Apparently, we make 25% more choices nowadays on a daily basis than we used to do back in the 80s. Can you imagine that? We make more than 3,500 choices a day. It's a lot. We have to choose absolutely everything. Just to give you an example, do you know that you can choose even in a hotel? I don't know if you know that. Nowadays you can choose, no? Even the type of pillow that you're gonna sleep in. You know, it's incredible, no? You have a pillow menu in the hotels. Have you seen that? Has anyone seen that? If you are staying in this hotel, by the way, look around the room and you're gonna find a pillow menu. To my surprise, I thought it was a joke when someone said that to me, but it's true. I mean, we are making choices every time. We have a trillion of websites on the internet. We really have to make a lot more choices because of technologies, no? Of the fast-paced life that we have now. So it's so much different from the past. And it obviously requires energy. It requires engagement, mental energy. You have to be there. And most of those choices are unconscious. So we have a lot of choice. I see my 2.5-year-old son going to YouTube Kids and scrolling through thousands of videos, you know, so quickly. And I was thinking, how does he make a choice? But he has his favorites. And it's so quickly. And I keep on thinking, how is it going to impact his choice making in the future? He's used to have so much, no? And I'm sure that you can relate to that if you have kids, no? Okay, then complexity. Complexity is not necessarily something bad. The problem is that we try to avoid complexity. But as we saw yesterday, our bodies are complex. No, we have here a complex system that works well together. We have no choice. Society is getting ever more complex in every single way. You can see it in politics, you can see it in history. Nowadays we have wars, we have global warming, we have all sorts of social problems, disasters. We have to live it all, no? Not different from the past. Perhaps the pace of everything is much faster nowadays. But we don't need to understand complexity as something unsolvable. I keep on saying that complexity is solvable. We just have to face it, understand it, and try and live it with it in the best way possible, because it's very likely that society is going to get even more complex from now on. And then there's chaos, no? Some people attribute the same to Nietzsche. From chaos comes order. I don't know how many of you have heard of that. I like another saying that I used to listen to in the UK 20 years ago. For there to be order, there must first be chaos. I find that very powerful, no? Because sometimes we perceive a situation as very difficult, as very problematic, but no, but slowly, and when we immerse ourselves, we can see some order come through, or we attribute some order to it. So I prefer to look at them in a positive way. And then we have individualism and tribalism. So let's think a little bit in terms of individualism. What has changed? Society has changed in a number of ways. Before, no, we used to be told what to do. For example, we were expected to get married in our 20s, no? 25 or so. Many of us, there was a tradition of following the profession of our parents, for example, or having a job for life. Those concepts are no longer valid. We know that it's very difficult to hold a job for life, right? So we have to keep on reskilling, upskilling, reinventing ourselves to kind of follow through social changes, no? So I think this is interesting because this authority that before was given by institutions, religion institutions sometimes, or the state, now it doesn't really quite hold in the society we live in. We are more capable of making our own choices, and we become, with that, more individualists. It's just a consequence of that, right? It's not necessarily a bad thing, right? But what does it mean? It means that we have to make more decisions all the time, and that we have to be on top of the things that we choose, happy with them. No? So whatever the difference here is from authority to otherness. This is the change in the post-industrial society. This otherness means the different, something that is not given to us as a standard. So the social order has changed a little bit. For example, everybody now can choose much more freely their sexual orientation. No? Women can vote. They can go to work, and as we saw yesterday, because of that and because of education, birth rates have been falling, right? So there is so much more now that we can do, and we do not live anymore on that society that was controlled for us. Of course, some people thrive with that, others are very scared. There are so many people that prefer that others make the choices for them. No? Perhaps we have students like that. And these are the people that we have to help most navigate this new social order with less anxiety. Okay, now, individualism here, no? Everybody likes to be treated as individuals. We can choose the type of Nespresso cafe we want to choose, ristretto, no, decaf. There are thousands of options, absolutely everything. All the time, what we buy, how we dress, how you get into a plane. Before, there were specific types of clothes for getting into a plane, for getting into a party. It's much more free nowadays, no? Individualism. Now, let's look at the other part of it. which is the collectivism, or what I call tribalism. It's our desire, our profound desire, to get together, to find our niche, to find our people, the ones that we relate to intellectually, no? Or that we relate to through a sport, or our people, no? We have this desire to belong, so it has to do with belonging. And it's normal, but if you see, it's kind of a paradox in relation to individualism, no? So we live that paradox daily, no? The individualism versus the need to find our tribe, right? Okay, but then comes the algorithms, and I just wanted to make a brief note on that. I think social media is excellent, you know, it's excellent that we can use social media in education. I think long is gone the time in which educators would tell students, switch off your mobile phones or switch off your laptop during the classroom. I don't want to see any of that. I think slowly, little by little, we have been learning, no, how to use technologies to the benefit of education. And it's fantastic. But when you talk about digital competence, it's not only about knowing how to use the technology, but having using the technology in a responsible way and understanding the impact it has on others and in ourselves. So when it comes to algorithms, although it's fantastic because it helps us make meaningful choices, it makes our lives easier, we all know here that, for example, the more you give a like on Facebook on some sort of post, the more you're going to see the same sort of post. No? So there is this repetitive pattern that this artificial intelligence understands that is our liking, what we would like to see. Therefore, it starts pushing towards us always the same type of content. And I think this is where us, as developers, as educators, as headmasters, as students, we have to be very aware of that. So that's the other part. That's seeing the elephant at a distance, no? Looking at the whole. What does it cause? Normally, people that are living in silos, or they think they are right, because everything they see is about the same thing. So they think everybody agrees with them. And when they see a contradictory idea, what do? Normally, they reject. No? So, okay, we have populisms, we have so many problems in politics, there are so many arguments in society with people that hold different points of view, and they are unable, really, to step back, step away, and look at them on a more critical perspective. So what I'm here saying today is that our role is also to think critically, no, and to try and engage students in this more type of critical thinking, because it's also part of digital competence, right? Okay, moving on. Let's look at the social challenges now. I told you that I would give you a zoom into European policy, the European perspective on social challenges, and here we go. We talk a lot about twin transition. The twin transition is the green and digital transition that we are planning now. We are planning it at the policy level, but we are also planning it with specific projects. Then we have skills, jobs of the future. It's impossible not to talk about jobs of the future when we talk about social challenges, no? We need to prepare the workforce, our students, to face what society needs now and what society, the types of job that society will need in the near future. Universities have to reframe their syllabus, no? What they teach, their courses, their master's courses, they have to speed up. And that's why we now have micro-credentials, micro-masters, no? And all those sorts of things that help the population reskill and upskill. And we have tools for that based on research, policies, and actual tools, and I'll show you a little bit. So the twin ingredients, the green and digital, are what we call the twin transition. But then the third transition is the social one, and that's the one I'm talking about. That's helping people think. And that's where STEAM subjects, not only STEM, but STEAM with an A for arts, understood as arts and humanities, become very important. I can see, attending conferences, reading papers, and seeing new projects, and reflecting, that ever more we need the social transition. We need people that are thinkers, and people that can critically understand, you know, their use of technology, how they use technology, how they push it forward, you know, and can filter and understand everything that goes towards them. So again, close to the elephant, and they step back away from the elephant, right? Social transition is the third one. So we've mentioned some of them. Climate change and adaptation. It's not only about climate change. We know that we need to adapt to the climate change. No? So we need new products. We need resilience. We need an understanding of what's going on so that we can change our own practices acting as individuals. Digital skills and competences. We have an aging population. So all that population, that rising population that we're seeing in the graphic yesterday, is getting old, no? And we have a problem there. Pensions, healthcare, and we need to look at them right now. Clean energy, renewables, clean hydrogen. We need to prepare more people for that. We need to transition our cars into cars that are electric. So there's so much to do and so many new jobs coming up. But how quickly are universities adapting to it? And do you really think that our generation understands the opportunities they have ahead? Because many of them complain not having jobs, not being feeling very difficult to get into the market, no? But maybe we're not really showing everything that is coming up right now. STEAM approaches and European values. European values has been identified as one of the main problems Europe faces right now. There are many countries through populist movements that want to separate from Europe. It's a tendency nowadays, no? And what you want to do is to increase the sense of belongingness, no? The European tribe inside of the world in the sense of raising the sense of values. What does it mean to be European? It doesn't matter if you're Italian, Greek, or Spanish, no? We are all Europeans. And if you think further, stepping away from the elephant in this room, we are all global citizens. We are part of the same planet. Now, very briefly, I won't get into details, but just for the ones who are interested, there's a lot of literature on what I'm talking about. The EDIF Cohesion Report, talking about the main challenges Europe is suffering right now, some of those I've mentioned just now. The PRI Playbook, Partnerships for Regional Innovation, is the biggest policy experiment ever in Europe that has been launched just a few months ago, and it has the intention to involve all sorts of stakeholders, so we are all here able to participate in one way or another. It's not only for governments, not only for education institutions, but for NGOs, for individuals, for students as well. And open education is cited in there. And the new era for Europe was launched just last week, and it talks about the triple transition, the social aspect of the transitions we are going through. Okay, in terms of policies, so we have studies at an European level. I'm sure that in your continent, you also find studies. If you look for them, UNESCO carries out many studies that can help us understand society nowadays. But in Europe, we also have policies. We have communications or recommendations to member states to understand the political scenario and to understand what drives, for example, funding, European funding for many things that we do. The European Strategy for Universities was launched this year in February 2022. And one of the things it does is it calls upon universities to embrace their third mission. We all know that universities have a kind of a triple mission, no? Which is research, innovation through research, education, teaching, but also the community side of things, which is to spreading that, to engage with the community, to spread that knowledge. And more than ever, in Europe, universities are being called upon to really materialize their third mission in very meaningful ways. So engaging with this conversation between citizens and knowledge transfer for transformative innovation. And a lot of it is done via opening up, via openness. We have the Digital Education Action Plan on the right-hand side, tackling the digital competence matter that I told you, that we need more of that. We have the micro-credentials recommendation, which is fantastic, no? Because it helps us create, it will be possible to create learning pathways and have courses that are shorter, that are more meaningful. It will enable us to combine degrees from different universities or micro courses. So we already have that in European policy. And finally, that one is the new innovation agenda for Europe. So it's talk about deep tech. It's very interesting in case you're thinking of, you're engaged with technology and innovation. I recommend you to have a look at these documents. They are accessible, they are online. And actually, you're going to have the links to that in my presentation, which will be in my blog later today. So you can just click in there and you see open education is also part of it. In terms of the PRI playbook, I told you it's the biggest policy experiment in Europe ever. Open education and open science is there in one of the tools, as one of the tools, FISH 59, should you are interested. So then we have these documents. No, we have all these European documents that support policy. And then finally, we have research. People like me and my colleagues, we are based in Seville, in the south of Spain. There, in there, we do education research for Europe. And we come up with, from our research, we always have to publish, we have to make it available in the form of reports and in the form of frameworks. So here we have the opening up education, the European framework for open education, in case you don't know what open education is about, and in case for you it's about OERs and MOOCs only, there is so much more to that, so we try to talk about it and explore it further. Computational thinking in compulsory education, how can we bring that as a subject for young kids to start understanding, no, computational thinking as a proper subject at school. We studied how different countries present it in different ways, right? And finally, the digital competence of educators. So it's all available. And from these studies, we create frameworks. Now, frameworks, they signal to us directions. They provide a common language for us to talk about, for example, open education, for us to talk about digital competence. In the digital competence framework, we are talking about empowering learners. So it's not only about the technology, it's about pedagogy, empowering learners, so on and so forth. I invite you to take a look at those as well, right? Then, from frameworks, we also create tools, technological tools, trying to operationalize these frameworks, bring it closer to people, to students, to teachers, to developers. So we created, at an European level, the Selfie for Teachers tool, focusing on school education, right? And here I'm talking really, coming back to that metaphor, to that analogy of the elephant, we now have our hands on, right? On the elephant, because we're talking about the practical side of things, getting close to what we are doing. Selfie for Teachers, if you go there, you as a school or as a teacher, no, from the school, you can go through a self-reflection process to assess your digital competence as an educator, right? If you're from higher education, your tool is the checking one, it's the one below. If you click there, you can reflect as well. And finally, once we propose these tools, what we do sometimes is to analyze an entire institution. You can ask all your teachers to use the checking tool if you are in higher education or the Selfie for Teachers tool. And that will provide you with a picture of their digital competence and therefore ways for you to promote professional development activities for them, right? Now, we've carried out this exercise in the entire country here in Spain. It took us about 4 years to carry out from the beginning to the end, from piloting and to results and a publication. But it's published. It's published now. More than 5,000 lecturers here in Spain, more than 53 universities participated in this study and gave us a nice picture of their digital competence. And that has led to new policies. You know? So what is the Spanish Minister of Universities going to do about this picture that we gave them in terms of digital competence of lecturers? And there's a lot going on. So it's policy feeding back into research, feeding back into practice, and that's a beautiful cycle. And this is why I said in the beginning, we have to be close, but sometimes we have to step back to get the full picture and see how we can reposition ourselves within that bigger context. This is what I just said. No, all these processes, identification of needs, research, policy, implementation, and research again. Now, the President of the European Commission, Ursula von der Leyen, last week gave a talk on the State of the Union. I don't know how many of you know that she, from time to time, gives a talk on the State of the Union. She talks about the most pressing issues in Europe, right? We know we are facing the war in Ukraine and all that it takes, all the sanctions, there are so many things that has been impacting Europe directly. But then she said, 2023 will be the year of skills. And that means a lot to us. That means a lot to all of us that are here today. No? What can we do to help that this becomes true? Because we really need a population to be upskilled. We have new jobs out there, and we have many people unemployed. We have a shortage of jobs, actually, of positions, because what we need is changing. How well are we preparing people in terms of skills? No? So just to give you a glimpse on the sorts of things that it's just a tiny snapshot of this whole area of jobs of the future and the future of jobs or future-proof skills. We say you need future-proof skills, skills that won't be obsolete, because if you're very good at a software today and it has an upgrade tomorrow, then you know, it's kind of, you're not good at it anymore. You have to keep on going, right? But there are certain skills that are future-proof, and those skills are related to humanities and arts. It's your creativity, entrepreneurship, problem-solving, critical thinking, everything that help you navigate through that complexity that I told you in the beginning. You can be absolutely fine with the complexity of society if you have developed yourself, you know, this type of skills. Now, jobs of the future. Oh, emerging jobs, I said there. No, just, I mean, I could give you 100 jobs. Ethical hacker. I think Martin mentioned the hacking there, that he thought that every student should be trying to hack the systems of their universities. No, the ethical hacker. Or the metaverse architects. We're already building the metaverse. Algorithmic transparency officer. You know, how can we understand algorithms in the future? Data privacy strategist. We already have data privacy officers, but strategists. How can we strategize privacy in data? Artificial intelligence educator, people that help us navigate through our domestic robots, learning robots, so on and so forth. And obviously, you know, everything comes at a price, you know? Perhaps a metaverse psychologist, metaverse psychiatrist, for the ones who are from the humanities. We keep on saying, it will be nice to do things in the metaverse, but the problem is when people get out of it and they have to face life again, no? Some will probably prefer to stay there, but we have to help them out. So when you talk about jobs of the future, we really talk about all these things. We do not know if it's going to be the case, but likely it will be, no? And then skills, the skills we already know, lifelong learning, autonomous learning. Everybody needs to know where to look for information, where to look for our MOOCs, to our platforms. Our Moodle open source platform and all the open content that is in there. No, most of the times, not always it's OER, but it can be an open educational resource, fully licensed, and we have to help people to be more aware of that. And creativity. So very briefly, so we are talking about what? When you talk about education for the future, I told you from the beginning, I see it as more technology-based. We are talking about digital content, OER, artificial intelligence, augmented reality, virtual reality, and you name it, okay? You name it. But then the how? Every more interoperable, customizable, that open-end tech mentioned yesterday seems to me a fantastic thing to do, connecting all universities, connecting all the content with nice filters, beautiful findability behind it, beautiful. Pedagogy, we cannot forget, active methodologies, challenge-based, problem-based, project-based, flipped classroom, there are many, no? Learner-centered blockchain technologies for micro-credentials so we can enable different learning pathways, no geographical boundaries, and autonomous learners. And now finally, let's get to the last one, openness. No, I told you that I would like to focus on openness, no, on the transformative power of openness. I am indeed an open education advocate. You know, I've been following this field since 2006, and I'm always amazed as to the power of openness. Look at this room, no? Moodle as an open source platform. No, you make it open, here we are. It's a beautiful community of engaging people, always contributing with new codes, with new ideas. And to me, That's the key for connection. Let's have a look at this Slido. Let me see if I can shift here to show you the results. The first one, what is open education for you? Accessible. That's the big one in the world. Then we have freedom, accessibility, which is different from access, thank you. We have opportunity, shared communication, availability. Opportunity, it's beautiful. It's the opportunity to learn, no? Opportunity to study. Equality, Shrek, for the future. Very creative, the creativity. So that's open education. And I told you, there is no single definition. But we need, the problem is, because we don't like to engage with complexity normally, we tend to think of open education in its simplest form. MOOCs, open licenses, and perhaps open science, no? But there is so much more to it. There's open pedagogy, open recognition, you know, recognition of non-formal learning so that you can have credits in different universities. And that means being more open in many different ways. A university can be open in different ways, and so can you. And my invitation today is exactly for you to think of what is your personal roadmap for connection, for openness, for tackling not only the elephant, not only touching your hand, the elephant for the practical things you do on a daily basis, but perhaps stepping back and see how, from this perspective of societal change, openness, what you can do as an open learner, as an open educator. Now we use that terminology, the open educator, so and so forth. Let's see the other one. You can see MOOCs, show results. Oh, you haven't answered that one, no? Oh, I asked you if it was available. Sorry. But anyway, so just for you to see, I asked you, which of the following open educational practices are you most familiar with? Quick hands up. Ah, now. Okay. What happened in there? Okay. Okay, brilliant. Oh, I'm surprised to see MOOCs winning from OUYA. Okay, recognition of non-formal learning, open science, and there is so much more. I didn't put more because there was no space to show you on the screen. But fantastic, we can see here MOOCs, because you probably develop the platforms or have to tackle the challenges of the platforms to offer MOOCs, no? And then the last one, finally, smart specialization strategies. Do you know what they are? No. Okay, not sure. Okay, I wouldn't expect you to know what smart specializations are, really. But I can tell you that it's an essential part of European policy, very briefly speaking, okay? You know that funding from the European Commission to the member states, they are released every 7 years, right? And then this funding is used in many different areas to build bridges, to help hospitals, to help students learn. So every country decides how they're going to apply European funding, right? And just now we are closing the period from 2021 to 2027 for countries to present to the European Commission their proposals for the next 7 years so that the Commission approves it and gives them funding, right? And one specific point is smart specialization strategies. Let's think. Smart specialization, let's think of a region, and let's think of what this region does best. In the case of Andalusia, where I live, the economy is about tourism and agriculture, right? So this is their strength. So what are they going to do in the sense of strengthening even more what they are already good at, you know, to have that competitive advantage? But also, so smart specialization, the specialization in certain areas in a smart way, okay? But also identifying what they need to do to have an innovation leap. So if they're falling behind, for example, I'm just giving you an example, in services provision, you know, what are the actions that the government is going to take to bridge that gap? So every country presents that project, and then they have to work for 7 years applying the funding and also revising and revisiting the achievements, you know, they have made towards that. So there is a mechanism behind, but I keep on thinking, can we use that in education? So instead of releasing just any MOOC, couldn't we be releasing the MOOCs that are totally related to our region, place-based innovation to help people from our communities to understand the challenges they face on a daily basis and to help them interact in their community to make the place they live better. Couldn't we be releasing also strategically MOOCs about climate change, climate adaptation, all those things that we understand, jobs of the future, skills, digital competence, everything that we already know, because it has been identified, are challenges not only for Europe, but perhaps for globally, not for many parts of the world. So to me, this is about system change. No? So we are very close to the elephant. We are developing the tools. But if we step back, then how do we use those tools? No, I think that's the other idea. That's the point of putting these concepts together and step into complexity to understand it rather than running away from it because we don't want to spend any energy on that. Okay? Right, let me go back to finalize. Okay, so educating for the future. Okay, so just to finalize, in conclusion, why open education is so transformative? Why does it have this power of transformation? Because it fosters inclusion in every single sense. It includes top-down and bottom-up actions. As I said, each one of us can have our own openness agenda. If you want to, of course, more or less. What can you make open? It's not only about teaching how to make tortillas on YouTube. You know, what else can you contribute positively to society that you think you can do? So together with that fine grain of sand, we can build the system change, this transformative change. So it can be done at an individual level, at a group level, as an open learner, as an open education. It can be the foundation for upskilling and reskilling, as we mentioned before. In there, it lies the power of transformative innovation. And to me, I think that it's always a question of mindset change. It's to think differently, to touch the elephant, and to step back sometimes, right? So I finalize with a quote that I like very much. Be the change you wish to see in the world. Thank you very, very much for your attention. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you so much, Andrea. That was really fantastic. You got me dreaming of using Moodle Next Gen to become a metaverse design, interior designer in the future.
Yeah.
So for when I grow up, maybe. so we are now going to take some questions from the floor. If you do have a question, put your hand up. Our mic runners, Adrian and Zoe, will come to you so that we can give you a microphone so that everyone can hear your question.
Hi, thank you very much for your talk. So you're talking to a room full of technological evangelists. How do we get everyone else to come across and, you know, put all these digital competencies into their day-to-day lives? Because we have to try and sell it to everyone else to try and, you know, build their digital skills. So how do we talk to them?
Yes, thank you very much. You're so right. I mean, those changes, they do not take place from one day to another. You know, what I've shown you here today, it's about years of research, because open education, digital competence, you know, digital skills, it's something that is very much fashionable nowadays, particularly post-COVID, but we've been researching and talking about it for years, you know, and finally we have that gap, unfortunately through COVID, but we have that gap of attention. So yes, how do we get everyone involved? I truly believe in the power of being an individual champion, you know, really being an advocate where you are, context-based, place-based, in your institution, at home with your kids, starting from there, because I've seen a lot changing from the bottom up. Institutions that were not considering opening up, open science, open educational resources or MOOCs, have really changed when they saw educational departments having specific actions, you know, experimenting with things. They realized the power of that. So change does not only take place from the top down. I think that it's difficult, but we can start within our own contexts. That's what I believe, okay? I know it doesn't solve anything very quickly, but it's a start.
Hi, Andrea. So my question is somehow related to the other one, which is how to bring this to life, which is something which probably you want to share about the project and everything what's happening, but also, as you say, about the individualists. And probably here are a lot of individuals who really created open education. So maybe you want to further access on what Europe is doing to encourage all of those policies to become life.
Yeah, thank you. You see, open education, as every policy, what happens in policy priorities, that it keeps changing. What is policy priority today may not be tomorrow. Suddenly the war in Ukraine came up and we had to put sanctions in Russia, for example. So that became policy priority. And then we have to help refugees in terms of education to keep up with coming to Europe, immigration, so that became policy priority. So, okay, but there is work going on in open education since the communication, 2013 communication on opening up education, right? So what we can do, we keep trying and feed open education into all those documents that I showed you, because then we always have a window of opportunity when we bid for a project or when you need to justify to your institution, to whoever, why you're going open, you say, well, it's part of European policy, and I can show you the paragraph of this important document that says blah, 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 blah. So it may sound silly, but in fact, it's not. It helps us to push the discourse forward, right? So we have open science featuring in the staff working documents of the innovation agenda. We have open education in the PRI playbook, the biggest policy experiment, right? And we keep on now embedding open education in mostly everything, because we understand as open education to a way for innovation. So watch out for future calls if you are in Europe, because you can always think of making that connection between policy documents, between innovation, smart specialization, open education and technologies, the sort of the ones that you work with, right?
Hi, thank you for your interesting presentation. My question is something that I see as a big gap in Europe is cross-wide recognition of certification, for example, for different skill sets. So for example, if I want to hire someone from Poland to do construction work, are there any movements or any projects to try and standardize certifications and actually make them open online across Europe?
Yes, I mean, that has been going on for years. It's so important what you're saying, thank you. That has been going on for years, and that's why we have the Bologna process, no? But we still have so much to do about it. So I think that the micro-credentials is a big leap forward, but I would highlight one recent initiative from the European Commission called European Universities. I do not know, how many of you know? Have you heard of European Universities? Only very few of you, but some. Okay, so this is exactly trying to tackle this gap. It's trying to put universities together from different countries. I think each hub of an European university needs to have universities from 6 different countries brought together to create a degree together and to issue a joint degree. So that's already a step forward, you know, in reducing bureaucracy, let's say, now in terms of recognition of certification, right? So they are trying, testing out models. The Commission is pushing that forward, providing funding. Universities are very much engaged with that, reporting back, and we expect this to grow over the next years. So I think that's one example of something happening in practice. And I wish one day we'll be able to see an European open degree, not just an European degree, no, but also an open European degree. I think that would be very beautiful. But we are on that road slowly, but we are going towards that direction. Thank you.
I think we have time for one more question. And since we have one in Slido, but since we have one in the room, we'll go to the room.
Okay. We'll talk later.
Just wondering what your opinion is on the balance between user choice and
Sorry, I didn't hear you.
Sorry, what's your opinion on the balance between user choice and technical support? So if I'm a user, I want it in my language, I want to use it in Facebook, that's what I'm familiar with, yet technically, are you going to be able to translate everything into every language, have it compatible with Zoom and with Teams and with TikTok and everything else out there?
I know, It's difficult. I'm not a developer, but I can only imagine what you face, right? Because I face that when people want to read these reports we produce in all the languages of the European Union. They say, oh, what do we do? And then normally we reach out to people who can help, you know, because sometimes we have budget for a formal translation, sometimes we don't. And then we put communities together and people offer, I will translate this report into Greek, I will translate into other languages. So perhaps it's a matter of collaboration, but then it depends on the type of company you're talking about, if it's for profit, if it's open source. To me, there's no clear answer, I'm afraid, but indeed it's something very important what you're saying. You know, there has to be a balance. We cannot provide everything at once, you know, but something to be thought about. Thank you.
Okay. Thank you, everyone. Thank you for your amazing questions. One last round of applause for Andrea. Thank you so much.